Welcome, everyone. Good morning, good afternoon, or good evening, depending where you are around the world. Thank you for joining our webinar today on e-cigarette aerosols. My name is Sherry Elzey. I'm a regional manager at TSI for the Particle Instruments Division. And with me is my colleague, Andrea Tawari, an applications engineer. And together, we'll be presenting on the challenges and methods for measuring e-cigarette aerosols. We'll start with an introduction to e-cigarettes, and then we'll look at the three stages of e-cigarette aerosol, including within the e-cigarette, as well as the user's exposure and secondhand exposure. And for those stages, we'll talk about experimental design and measurement options and show some example data. Then we'll wrap it up with a summary and a Q&A session. If you have any questions during the webinar, please enter them in the Q&A box, and we will go through those at the end. An e-cigarette is an electronic device containing a liquid that's vaporized and inhaled, and it usually contains nicotine. Now, globally, there are 55 million people expected to be e-cigarette users by 2021. And the global market is about $19 billion. The use of e-cigarettes has become very widespread. In the US, about 20% of people age 30 or younger report vaping at least occasionally. Because of this trend, there's a lot of interest in researching e-cigarette aerosols to understand the health effects, and there are many publications available on this topic. For this webinar, the scope is going to include electronic nicotine delivery systems, or ENDS, that are widely commercially available and manufactured for standard operation. Usually, the devices are disposable or they use disposable cartridges, and the nicotine material is produced using a standard process that has quality controls. We won't be focusing on customized devices that are available that may use non-standard active ingredients or not have quality controls. I'll review some terminology that will be used throughout the presentation. An e-liquid is typically a glycerol or propylene glycol matrix, and it's used to transport the nicotine and the flavors. Activation method refers to the way that the device is turned on or off. This is normally either pneumatic or push button or a combination of both. The device morphology refers to the physical properties of the device. This may include things like shape, size, the heating coils, the airflow rate, and so on. And the puff profile. This is the cyclic method of activating the device for analysis, and it's usually described by the time the device is on and off. Now, like a traditional cigarette, an e-cigarette provides a puff of aerosol for the user to inhale. This puff profile typically includes 3 seconds of drawing where the device is activated. This is followed by a short 3 to 5 second hold in the user's mouth or lungs, followed by exhaling for about 30 seconds. More details on the standard puff profile are defined in the ISO standard shown on this slide. Now, e-cigarette aerosol is harder to inhale than traditional cigarettes. This is because the flow rate and the velocity are lower during inhalation. So e-cigarette aerosol is unique in its composition and in its growth dynamics relative to traditional cigarettes. If we look at the evolution of an e-cigarette aerosol plume, there are 3 stages. Stage 1 occurs inside the device, and it exists on a very rapid timescale of micro to milliseconds. Then stage 2 occurs at the exit of the device, and this represents the user's exposure. This stage is also very fast on a time scale of milliseconds to seconds. Stage 3 is the aerosol that spreads to the surrounding area, and this represents exposure, secondhand exposure for bystanders. The time scale of this is seconds to minutes. Now we'll take a closer look at what's happening in stage 1 as the e-liquid is volatilized by heating in the device, usually to around 100 to 200 degrees Celsius. Inside the e-cigarette, the liquid is composed of propylene glycol, glycerol or glycerin, nicotine and other derivatives and flavors, and may have some byproducts. Other parameters that are relevant for the aerosol include the activation method of the device morphology, and the puff profile. So these are parameters that a researcher may want to vary in order to study their effects, or they may want to control for these depending on the type of research question that you're asking. But it's important to be aware of all these parameters, especially when doing a literature review and making comparisons between different data sets. Now we'll take a closer look at what's happening in stage 2. This is a very dynamic system. It includes particle formation, a very high concentration of particles, and supersaturation of the e-liquid compounds. When the aerosol exits the electronic cigarette, multiple processes are taking place. There's nucleation of particles, there's condensation, there may be growth due to coagulation or water uptake within the body. There's gas phase and particle phase partitioning. And all of these processes are happening simultaneously, and they result in very rapid dynamics. And this leads to changes in the properties of the aerosol that you're trying to measure. And this is really why e-cigarette aerosol can be so challenging to characterize. Ideally, people would like to generate an aerosol with a concentration, a size, and a composition that are realistic for the user. This way you can understand the health effects and model the deposition. But due to the complexity of the plume, there are design issues that are taking place. So there will be particle losses, and this will reduce the concentration of the aerosol. Coagulation will also affect the concentration and the size. Volatilization will affect the size and the composition of the particles. And water uptake will also affect the size and the composition. So these are important issues to be aware of and to consider when coming up with an experimental design. Now, this schematic shows the most basic overview of the experimental setup. In any aerosol measurement setup, there is always aerosol generation, there is conditioning and transport of the aerosol, and then sampling and data analysis. All the measurements will be affected by the details of each of these 3 stages. Now, in the literature, many different setups have been used to study e-cigarettes. And we want to note that an approach shouldn't be seen as either being right or wrong, but there are different setups that are useful for different goals, and it may depend on what question the researcher is asking. Every setup will have its own benefits and limitations, and so we will address that as well. If we consider the first step of generation, the electronic cigarette is the aerosol generator. As I mentioned earlier, there are many different brands and types of e-cigarettes with varying device morphologies. You can see an example of many different sizes and shapes here. There's also a huge variety of e-liquids to choose from. And the type of e-cigarette, the way that it's operated, and the material that you're using will all affect the generated aerosol properties. In the second step, conditioning and transport refers to everything between the point of generating the aerosol and the point of sampling the aerosol. All measurements will require some form of transporting the aerosol, but many setups also include intentional conditioning steps because they serve a purpose for the research goal. So I'll review some common examples that are used in e-cigarette studies. A puffing or smoking machine is often used in these studies. It provides a convenient way to activate the device. It can also control the puff profile. It may offer pre-programmed profiles that the user can choose from. And it can also provide a way to connect the e-cigarette aerosol output to the sampling device. Now, within these machines, there can be a long length of tubing, and this will increase residence time and cause diffusion losses. Simulators are also used in many studies. These can be things like mouthpieces or throat simulators, also known as induction ports. These are especially common in studies that are related to pharmaceutical research, where researchers are looking at drug delivery and aerosol deposition, because they're used to simulate the aerosol path during the inhalation phase. But these simulators will also add residence time, and you can see they have some bends and elbows in the path, and these will cause impaction of larger particles. Due to the very high concentration of e-cigarette aerosol, dilution is used in most setups. It's often necessary in order to meet the concentration limits of the instruments that are being used to measure the aerosol. It's usually accomplished one of two ways, either with a commercially available diluter, which has a known dilution ratio, or people use a HEPA filter with a flow meter and valve, and they add as much dilution air as needed, and then they calculate their dilution ratio from that. But dilution will affect the evaporation and coagulation processes of the volatile compounds in the e-liquid. Many setups also include a chamber or a small volume for aging the aerosol. A chamber can be a really convenient way to connect to multiple sampling devices. If you have three or four ports in the chamber and you connect different instruments to them, it can also be used to intentionally age the aerosol and study the effects of aging. And sometimes people use a smaller volume of about 50 milliliters as a residence volume in order to mimic that mouth hold phase of the inhalation process. But chambers and aging will result in more coagulation as well as more particle losses. So if we summarize these different approaches that can be included and sort of their benefits and their effects on the particle size distribution, the smoking machine and simulators can provide convenient ways to activate the device and provide a controlled path for delivering it to the sampling system. They will increase the size of the aerosol that's measured and decrease the concentration. Dilution is beneficial because it can help you meet the detection limits of the instruments you're using. It will also minimize coagulation. So greater dilution will result in smaller particle size being measured, as well as lower concentration. For chambers or aging, it provides a convenient way for multi-port sampling and is also useful when you want to study the effects of aging. It will result in increased particle size as well as decreased concentration. In the final step of the setup, the aerosol is detected and the data are analyzed. Now, there's a variety of technologies that can be used to do this. And Andrea is going to go through these in more detail, but some of the common ones are impaction, particle counters that measure concentration, particle sizers that measure size distribution using different methods. An important consideration for the technology that you use is the measurement speed. Is it able to capture transient data or is it time averaged data? This is very relevant for e-cigarette aerosol because if you remember the time scale that the different stages of a plume exist on, how fast the measurement is will determine what part of the plume you're able to capture. You need transient measurements to be able to see the particle nucleation and growth. Slower measurements may capture some coagulation, and slower measurements will really only be looking at stage 3 of the plume. And then the data presentation is an important consideration, especially when you're reviewing literature and you're trying to compare results from different studies. It's common for people to use number-based or mass-based weightings to plot their size distribution. So here I'm showing a plot that really shows the effect of using these two different weightings. On the top, you see an aerosol size distribution that's plotted in number concentration, and most of the distribution is below 100 nanometers. Below that is the same aerosol size distribution, but now it's switched to a mass weighting. And you can see that the bulk of the distribution is now up in the large micron size. And this is the same aerosol size distribution because the smaller particles don't contribute much to the mass. So this is just something to think about in how you want to present your data and how you compare data among itself. And so at this time, I'm going to turn it over to Andrea to go into more detail about the different methods that are available to measure e-cigarette aerosol.
Hi, everyone. There are several types of instruments we'll talk about that are used for e-cigarette measurements. Most of them provide number-based data, as Sherry was alluding to. But the first we'll talk about can easily provide mass-based data, since you collect the particles and then you can weigh your collected samples. This technique is called a cascade impactor, and it provides size-segregated sampling. Depending upon the type of offline analysis you do, this permits you to obtain size-segregated mass or chemical data. Cascade impactors direct a sample flow through a series of cascading nozzles. Each stage may consist of one nozzle or many, and immediately after the nozzles are plates. Particles that are too large to follow the air sample's streamlines impact onto the stage where they deposit on a substrate. This continues through all the stages as successively smaller particles are collected as you go. After the final stage, an after filter is used to capture any remaining particles. Cascade impactors are designed to be used at a constant specific flow rate. The number of stages varies from 3 to 13 depending upon the model you choose. An 8-stage model, 135-8, is often used for e-cigarette research. This model has a low flow rate of 2 liters per minute, which minimizes dilution of the e-cigarette aerosol. This 135-8 model is a mini Moody impactor, part of a larger family of Moody impactors available from TSI. Here is an example of mass-based data that you can obtain using an 8-stage impactor. Traditional cigarettes and an e-cigarette aerosol was sampled through an impactor, resulting in 8 size-segregated samples. Weighing each sample shows that the majority of the aerosol mass was located in the range of 0.56 to 1 micrometer. The application note on use of mini Moody impactors for e-cigarette aerosol research can be found at the link on this slide. Use of mini Moody 135 for this application has also been demonstrated in published literature. In this open access paper from 2014, Alderman and colleagues used a cascade impactor to measure the mass-based sized distribution of aerosols from 3 brands of e-cigarette. The distribution shown here was typical for all 3 tested brands. Fitting a curve to the mass data obtained from weighing the collected samples produced mass median aerodynamic diameters, or MMADs, of these aerosols from 490 to 630 nanometers. A few moments ago, I mentioned that impactors are designed to be used with a constant specific flow rate. This need for a constant flow rate seems to be in direct conflict with the notion of a puff profile, where an e-cigarette will have a flow drawn through it for a few seconds, but then sit idle for a longer period of time, as Sherry described earlier. How do researchers meet both of these criteria simultaneously? They do so using a schematic similar or probably identical to this. Oldham and colleagues provided a constant 2 liter per minute flow to their mini Moody impactor and also kept the flow through the e-cigarette device to the flow rate they desired, in this case 0.66 liters per minute, and according to a puff profile of 5 seconds on, 25 seconds off. One solenoid valve controls this system. In such a fashion, the flow requirements for both e-cigarettes and instrumentation can be satisfied. In that same paper, Oldham and colleagues needed to collect samples over the course of only 3 puffs to collect enough mass on their substrates for gravimetric analysis. Using this technique for 20 different e-cigarette products, they found the MMAD values to be very consistent, ranging from 0.9 to 1.2 micrometers for these devices. While these two works showed MMAD particle sizes ranging from 0.5 to a little over 1 micrometer, a number-based view of the data would certainly show many of the particles being far smaller than that. Several instruments are capable of providing number-based data in the sub-micrometer range, the most common of which is the Scanning Mobility Particle Sizer, or SMPS, as shown here. SMPS systems measure the size distribution of sub-micrometer aerosols. The exact size range is determined primarily by the model of DMA that is selected as part of the system. Many of you may be familiar with how an SMPS works, but in case you are not, here's an overview. The SMPS is made up of several components. Flexibility in these components gives users the power to select a system that most closely fits their particular needs. The first component is the electrostatic classifier, model 3082. This is the instrument on the left. It controls voltages in the DMA, which we'll talk about in a bit. It houses two other components, the neutralizer and the inlet impactor, and it communicates with the CPC, which is at right. Almost all configurations of the SMPS system can be run entirely from the front screen of the classifier. The data is saved to the instrument and obtained using a USB stick. The second component is the differential mobility analyzer, or DMA. This acts as a bandpass filter for particles, emitting particles of only one given size at a time. Voltage is used to determine particle size using the concept of electrical mobility. Polydispersed particles enter the inlet at the top of the DMA, and monodispersed particles exit the bottom of the DMA and flow toward the CPC. The DMA scans its voltage to change the size of particles emitted. This scanning voltage capability is how a particle size distribution can be obtained quickly. The final component is the condensation particle counter, or CPC, shown at right. The CPC counts single particles by condensing a liquid onto them in order to grow those tiny particles large enough for optical detection. So while the DMA controls particle size, the CPC counts the resulting microdispersed particles. Together, this is how an SMPS system measures a submicrometer aerosol size distribution with high resolution. Because of this capability, SMPS systems have been widely used to measure e-cigarette aerosol. In this 2019 work, Lecasseur and colleagues investigated the effect on the aerosol size distribution of both e-cigarette liquid flavor and also the blend of propylene glycol and glycerin in the e-liquid. Plots A and B show that the presence of vanillin flavor resulted in larger particles than were produced when the other three tested flavors were present. In the lower half, plot C, we see the results of varying the composition of the e-liquid from 70% propylene glycol and 30% glycerin, or the reverse. We see that in some of the tested flavors, this glycerol blend changed the size distribution somewhat, but that pattern didn't hold for the fourth tested flavor, where you can see no change. These results not only demonstrate the strength of the SNPS to observe changes like this, but also illustrate the complexity of e-cigarette aerosol research given the number of variables present. A second instrument capable of providing number-based data is shown here, the Engine Exhaust Particle Sizer, or EEPS. A very similar instrument, the Fast Mobility Particle Sizer, or FMPS, is also a suitable tool. These instruments have one attribute that is very valuable for this application, that being speed. These instruments can measure an entire size distribution in 1 second, and in the case of the EEPS, in 1/10 of a second. This is very useful when measuring aerosols as dynamic as those from e-cigarettes. So how do these fast sizers work? How can they provide an entire size distribution so rapidly? Multiple detectors is the key. The EEPS and the FMPS employ an inside-out DMA, so to speak, using the electrical mobility of particles to force them, in this case outwards, towards a detector. And in these fast sizing instruments, there are multiple detectors. So the entire size range of 5.6 to 560 nanometers is all measured simultaneously. This enables you to capture rapid changes in the size distribution occurring on the timescale of seconds or subseconds. At 10 liters per minute, the EEPS and FMPS have a higher inlet flow rate than does the SMPS. This higher flow rate is necessary to enable such rapid size measurements.
Now I'll share some data that was collected using the techniques that Andrea just discussed. Last year, we had the opportunity to work with researchers at the Mayo Clinic in Dr. John Ebert's lab. And we used the four e-cigarette devices shown here on the left. The experimental setup used either a smoking machine or push button to activate the devices. And then we split the flow into four different instruments. One was the EEPS that you just heard about, as well as an optical particle sizer, or OPS, which allowed us to measure larger aerosol up to 10 micrometers. We also had the Mini Moody impactor to collect the material, as well as a CPC for total concentration. In front of the two sizers, we had diluters so we could meet the concentration limits of those instruments. And then we also had a path for filtered air to come in so that the instruments could pull the flow that they needed. Here we're looking at the sub-micrometer size range, and this is time averaged data comparing the mode particle size of each of the four devices. You can see they were all in the range of about 100 to 150 nanometers. For the TOAS device, we were able to change the wattage, and so we studied the size distribution at different wattages. And what we saw was that the wattage level really didn't affect the shape of the size distribution, but it did have an impact on the concentration output. Now on the lower part of the screen, you see the total particle concentration for each of the devices. On the left, note that the log scale of the y-axis is a log scale, so there are some significant differences between the devices there. And then on the lower right, we also see the same trend in the concentration at different wattage settings for the TOAS device. With the two particle sizers that we were using, the EEPS and the optical sizer, we were able to collect data as fast as 0.1 hertz. And so we captured time resolved size distributions during a single puff. We had a puff profile of a 3 second draw followed by a 25 second wait. I'm showing example for the USONASIG on the upper left where we captured replicate puffs. You can see two distinct size modes, one down near 10 nanometers and the larger one up around 100 nanometers. You can also see how rapidly each puff came in, reached a peak concentration, and then diminished. If you imagine taking one of those single puffs and blowing it up, that's what you're looking at on the upper right. I'm showing an example for the logic device. And here you're able to see 30 distinct size distributions during that 3 second puff. This lets you see more fine detail where that smallest mode is there initially. Then it diminishes and shifts to slightly larger particles. And you can see again how quickly the entire puff came in quite quickly and then diminished. Now in the lower plot, we are combining the data from the EAPS and the OPS. So on the y-axis, we're seeing a large size range from about 5 nanometers up to 10 micrometers. And this again was for a single puff and then the time evolution on the x-axis. So this kind of map shows you a very large overview picture of a wide size distribution and the full time scale for a puff. And we also collected the samples using the Mini Moody Impactor. There's a picture of the TAWIS device being activated. And then you can see on the impactor stage, the aerosol collected. And our collaborators at Mayo used NMR analysis to quantify the relative nicotine distribution for each of the devices. So that plot below is showing the percent nicotine for the mass collected for each device against the aerodynamic size from the impactor stages. You can see the TAWIS had the highest nicotine output and also in the largest sizes. Now they also looked at material other than nicotine. You can look at the propylene, glycol, and so on. And this type of information is very useful for predicting drug delivery and can be used in lung deposition models. So now Andrea will go through a couple more sizing options and discuss the final stage of the plume.
Thanks, Sherry. Lastly, there are two other instruments we'll briefly mention, the APS and the LAS. APS stands for Aerodynamic Particle Sizer and directly measures the aerodynamic size of particles using a time of flight technique. It sizes over the range of 0.523 to 20 micrometers with an upper concentration limit of 1,000 particles per cubic centimeter. The LAS has a wider size range of 90 nanometers to 7.5 micrometers and uses an optical technique to determine particle size. While the APS has fixed size bins, an LAS user can configure the size channels. Peer-reviewed literature demonstrating the use of each of these instruments for e-cigarette aerosol is shown near the end of our presentation. To conclude our discussion of the instruments, let's touch back to our plume of e-cigarette aerosols. Recall how we divided that plume into stages. Any of the instruments we've talked about can be used to measure aerosol properties here in stage two. Recall that the research goal here is to measure what an e-cigarette user is exposed to and to do so while minimizing changes to aerosol properties. Each of the instruments, impactors, SMPS, EAPS or FMPS, APS, and LAS, has certain strengths that make it a valuable tool for e-cigarette research. Choosing between them depends on the specifics of one's research question or research design. Questions such as time resolution, size resolution, and the necessity of collecting a physical sample are important considerations when selecting instrumentation. Some researchers, however, are interested in the question of secondhand e-cigarette aerosol exposure. These researchers want to measure any aerosols derived from e-cigarette use in the surrounding area to assess the risk to bystanders. The timescale in this case is seconds to minutes, and gas particle partitioning has come to or near a quasi-equilibrium with the surroundings. Published work in this research area has found that while e-cigarettes produce observably lower backgrounds than traditional cigarettes, there may still be elevated particle levels relative to background. Lampos and colleagues measured aerosols in a 35 cubic meter room after an e-cigarette was quote-unquote smoked by an automated machine. The room had 0.6 air changes per hour. These plots show that the aerosol size distribution measured after e-cigarette use was nearly identical to the background, suggesting that partitioning of e-cigarette aerosol compounds into the vapor phase is fairly rapid. In a separate study, however, Schripp and colleagues found elevated particle levels for bystanders. The impact of e-cigarette use on indoor air quality, then, may depend significantly on several details. Looking at the effect of e-cigarette use on indoor air quality overall, we see that the aerosol is mainly in the PM1 range, and the PM mass concentration is substantially higher than the World Health Organization advises for outdoor air. Deposition of these aerosols in the human respiratory system varies by body size. Since 60 to 80% of the particles appear to be below 100 nanometers in size, infants are more likely to receive higher doses. Protano and colleagues note that translocation of these particles to the brain may be possible. As with all things related to indoor air quality, the ventilation rate is a key factor determining exposure. And while ISO standards exist for measuring the impact of traditional cigarettes on indoor air quality, published research is starting to use those standards when investigating similar questions for e-cigarette use. So let's summarize. E-cigarettes, or ENDS, have a large and growing user base. As we discussed earlier, characterizing e-cigarette aerosol is challenging because the system is so dynamic. The researcher can make certain experimental design choices to try to preserve a particular aerosol attribute as much as possible. Instrument choice is part of that design process. Many studies have found that the great majority of aerosols, from a number-based perspective, are smaller than 1 micrometer in size. Secondhand exposure may be a risk, and in that light, ISO standards are beginning to be incorporated into experimental work. Published peer-reviewed literature using each of the instruments we discussed for the two different types of exposure are shown here. Full references for those and other papers are shown here. And with that, we'd like to thank you very much for your attention today. Please feel free to submit questions using the Q&A function within WebEx, as some of you already have. You may also email us using the email addresses shown here. Sherry and I, of course, have been your presenters today. Excuse me. And Dr. Francisco Romay is the product manager for the Moody Impactors. So this concludes our presentation, and we will look forward to addressing your questions in the Q&A session. So I see one question. Do e-cigarettes have HEPA filters inside of them, or are the HEPA filters only being used in the testing of the e-cigarette? I presume that HEPA filters are not located inside of e-cigarettes, since the purpose of them is to emit a lot of aerosols to inhale. But that said, I have not worked on e-cigarette design or for a company that produces e-cigarettes, so I can't answer definitively in that regard. We have another question. How are particle sizes binned by the SMPS? In other words, what is the actual size range that falls within each reported size? So that's a good question. The reported sizes are midpoints of the bins, and the bins are spaced evenly on a logarithmic scale. I believe we have an app note that helps describe this. And to go into more detail, please feel free to email me, Mr. Hill, and then we can handle that question in more detail via email. Oh, someone else chimes in. Thank you very much for this. Someone says, you are correct that e-cigarettes do not use filtration, not least because with a wet aerosol, the pressure drop increase would be unacceptable to the user. That's an excellent point, so thank you for that. And someone else chimes in, there are no filters inside. My research team has disassembled most devices and there are no filters. Okay, another question. If EEPs or FMPS operate at approximately 10 liters per minute, there will need to be dilution flow added prior to sampling. Is there a potential for this dilution to impact particle size? And the short answer is yes. Any dilution that you do can impact particle size. So it's always a question of balance, right? What property are you trying to measure? You know, what trade-offs can you make? That's what makes e-cigarette aerosol research so challenging. Someone is asking, what is the optimal dilution level? And I would say that's a good question. I don't think there is one clear answer. I think literature review on including papers that answer a research question very similar to the one you would like to answer would be the most important resource for you. Someone asks, how often do we need to clean the instrument, whether it's SMPS, FMPS, or APS, if we use them for e-cigarette study? That is a good question. It will vary by instrument. For each of these instruments, we have guidance in the manual or via a maintenance guide or via contacting application support, such as myself, to help you understand how often you need to clean the instruments, whether it's e-cigarette use or otherwise. There are some diagnostic criteria specific to each instrument model that you can follow that will tell you, now I should clean. How do you determine the dilution ratio when you use SMPS or EEPS? The dilution ratio that you would look for would be how much dilution occurs between the mouth of the e-cigarette, you know, the output of it, and the input of your instruments. So let's say that you have a SMPS, you're operating at 1.5 liters per minute, and you've measured your e-cigarette output at 0.6. Then you have those two numbers, you know how much dilution air you're adding, and you can do the math there. Can the e-cigarette research methods and results translate to viral aerosol research? That's an interesting question. Sherry, do you have any thoughts on that? I think it might be a fairly detailed conversation that might be better conducted by email. I'm not sure if you would like to chime in on that.
Yeah, I think that's something where we might have a more valuable discussion if we take it offline and have some time to think about that and look into it.
Okay, super. So the person who asked that question, Marcos, please feel free to email us and we'll be happy to discuss with you. Okay, I see a question. If one was going to measure the aerosol further downstream after dilution with the ambient, can we use the instruments EEPS, OPS, SMPS without a diluter, apart from what occurs within the instrument? What could go wrong with sampling a raw aerosol? The reason people dilute in stage two is that the instrument concentration limits get overwhelmed. But if you're not sampling in stage two, if you're sampling across the room, it's of its secondhand exposure, as you're suggesting, with dilution with the ambient, then I don't think any dilution would be needed. So I suppose whether or not dilution is needed really depends on the specifics of where you're sampling. Can we use the colosan nebulizer to generate the aerosol to mimic the e-cigarette aerosol? I suppose you could characterize the colosan nebulizer output and use literature review to argue that, look, these published literature found a size similar or a concentration similar or a composition similar to what I'm getting with my colosan, thus my colosan is an acceptable substitute. Well, I don't think we can advise on that, so I guess I would just say proceed with literature review. Is the hygroscopic growth factor of e-cigarette particles known? That's an interesting question. I don't think I know the answer to that question. I'm confident that they do grow. Oh, and we have a response from a colleague here at TSI, and he says, yes, the growth factor is known. So literature review will hopefully be able to shed light on that. How do you distinguish between volatiles and non-volatiles? I suppose that could be distinguished depending on your sampling method. If you can use a sorbent cartridge and then do a thermal desorption GC technique, that could give you volatiles. There is precedent for that within the Schripp paper. Schripp, I think it's 2013, who did secondhand e-cigarette aerosol exposure. That would be at least one place you could look for gas phase sampling of e-cigarette emitted compounds. Okay, and there is a growth factor for the hygroscopicity question in the paper. In this presentation with the first author of Wright, W-R-I-G-H-T. These slides will go out and a recording will go out, so you'll have all the references. So for the hygroscopicity question, look at the right paper. For the volatility question and sampling those vapor phase compounds, look at the Schrip paper. Here's another question. Do you expect an influence on the temperature inside the investigated e-cigarette, especially the tank or the mouthpiece, due to the experiment? For example, would you get more heat than expected from... An interesting question. My first guess is no, but that said, I have not conducted... Let's see. So yes, temperature greatly affects aerosol size, but do you know... asking my colleague Tim, who is on the webinar here, do you know if experiment results in a different temperature than normal use would result in? I think that's the question. I imagine you would need to subject the e-cigarette to a substantially higher pressure drop or substantially different flow or something like that than you would have in normal use to induce a different temperature than would occur during normal use. Okay, in this case, regarding the temperature, I think it might be better to move that question to email so we can have more details in our conversation. So Nadia, please feel free to email us and we'll be happy to discuss that with you. I'm just looking through the questions to see if there are any that I missed. Can you cover the techniques and tools with minimum dilution to avoid aerosol evolution influencing sizing? So I think you're asking, can we summarize which techniques require the minimum amount of dilution? If that's your question, then I think the answer is, impactors, since they are not doing an electronical detection, then you're just sampling the aerosol onto a substrate. So thank you for confirming that that is your question. The impactors don't require you to dilute anything. So you're just pulling the aerosol in and depositing it on a substrate. I think it was in the Oldham paper where they only needed to do 3 e-cigarette puffs until they got enough mass to weigh it on those substrates. And certainly those substrates are size segregated, right? You don't have one substrate capturing all of the mass. You have it capturing a subset of the mass. So the impactors don't require any dilution. Oh, so someone chimes in about the hygroscopic growth factor of e-cigarette aerosol is around 2, according to one of our attendees today. So thank you very much for that. Another question, has mass spectrometry been used to analyze e-cigarette volatiles with the size characterization? That's an interesting question. So you would need to sample the aerosol using the Moody impactor, so you had the size segregation, right? And then with those substrates, extract them and do some mass spec. My presumption is yes, that's been done. I cannot think off the top of my head of a paper that I can point you to, but my presumption is that has been done. It's possible that in one of the references in this paper that it is in there and I just didn't see it. So I'd encourage you to look through those and see what you can find. Can you comment on different in size distribution of aerosol and nicotine in a puff? That's a good question. So where, if you had a size distribution of the aerosol, and then if you could sample all those different sizes, do chemical analysis on all those different sizes and look for nicotine, does the nicotine size distribution look the same? And I want to say it does. There's a paper, the first author I believe is Mulder, M-U-L-D-E-R, I believe it's in Scientific Reports, and they looked at that question, and I believe that those distributions turned out to be approximately the same. Oh, someone confirms that it's Mulder. Yes, thank you. Let's see. What factor will greatly affect e-cigarette particle size, temperature, power, or e-liquid? I would say all of the above. I think temperature and power perhaps a little bit more than e-liquid, but we do know that the e-liquid composition can change the size distribution. So all of them are relevant. Oh, Francisco points out there is some dilution with the mini Moody impactor since it's pulling at 2 liters per minute, but this is the lowest, probably the lowest dilution ratio case. Is the sheath flow of SMPS diluting the aerosol? I would say it's not diluting the aerosol since you have the same e-cigarette flow rate coming into the DMA and then that as coming out the bottom of the DMA, that aerosol is exposed to the sheath flow, but it's not that it's, you know, adding 10 liters per minute more of air and now it's a, you know, factor of 10 dilution. Okay, an excellent resource. Our colleague Timothy Wright, who is our regional manager for the Southeastern US, has chimed in that the supplementary information of his paper, which the reference is in this slide deck, WRIGHT, the supplementary information for his paper discusses diffusion of e-cigarette aerosol constituents to sheath flow. So thank you very much. That's an excellent resource. So we'll give it a few more minutes, see if any more questions are submitted.
It looks like there were separately some questions entered in the chat.
Oh, were there? I've missed those. Thank you. Let's see. Yeah, let me get over to the chat feature.
There's a question about will cannabis delivery be evaluated also. I know there certainly are labs researching that. I'm not familiar with how similar or dissimilar that is to e-cigarette vapor.
I see a question, how volatile are the particles and how much is their size or mass affected by sampling in a Moody or size distribution measurement, such as in an SMPS? Well, how volatile are the particles? Quite. If you recall the Lampos paper for which I showed a plot, the e-cigarette aerosol distribution across the room from a smoking machine that was smoking, quote unquote, an e-cigarette, that distribution was negligibly different from background, you know, or, you know, very comparable. How much is their size or mass affected by the sampling? I think that's a very good question. I don't think we can give a single quantifiable answer in that regard. Literature review, I mean, there's certainly plenty of published literature, and literature review has also been undertaken. So perhaps there are some literature review papers out there who will attempt to answer that question in a quantitative fashion. I think it's a good question.
There's a question, is there a comparable study or webinar available for measuring nanoparticles in wood smoke? I don't know that we have a webinar available for that, but we have used our instruments to study wood smoke and other feedstocks. So we can say from that experience that they do work equally well for that application.
Yes, and I'm sure there's published literature on use of these instruments for wood smoke as well. Someone asks, which country has the highest use of e-cigarettes? That's a good question. I don't know the answer. I suppose there's different ways one could look at it. Number of e-cigarette users versus percent of the population. You know, so there are different ways that could be looked at. I know it's the U.S. probably constitutes a large portion of the market. I don't know if it's the largest. One question, are public health exposure standards or occupational exposure standards applied to the results of measurements. So I think the question is, when researchers are making these measurements, are the researchers then comparing those values to public health exposure standards or occupational exposure standards? I'm not sure if people are doing it, and I suppose it depends on what that researcher's motivation is. Are they intending for public health, folks who have interest in public health, stakeholders in public health, stakeholders in occupational exposure? Is that the intended audience for the researcher? They might not even, you know, be informed of those standards. So I think if that comparison has not been done very much in literature to date, it certainly could be done. Is there any temperature and humidity control in TSI aerosol measurement devices? There are temperature and humidity measurements, but I guess I would say not temperature or humidity control. That is something that possibly could be done to some extent, depending on the situation, and I would encourage anyone with interest in that regard to be in touch with TSI in that regard, either through your regional manager, such as Sherry, or through application support, such as myself.
We have a question in the chat. Do you worry that e-cigs will gunk up the instruments? I would say the main thing there is to make sure that you reduce your concentration so that it's within the range of the instruments. But other than that, no, they are designed to measure these types of aerosols, and there are some regular maintenance for all of the instruments, but I wouldn't worry about e-cigarette research doing any harm to the instruments.
Okay, our colleague Tim, who does have e-cigarette research experience, says that the aerosol can affect the plumbing leading to the instruments. So that plumbing may need cleaning. I see a question in chat about APC and LPC. So I presume you mean APS and LAS. And the question also involves mass distribution particle size. If you could please clarify your question, then we can give it a shot. I'm not sure I understand it as of now. So we were talking about the cleaning, how you might need to do cleaning between the e-cigarette and the instruments for that that pipe, that tubing. Does the length of that tubing that's used in the experiment considerably affect the transport time and or residence time? Yes, it could. Because if your instruments are on the other side of the room and you need to use multiple meters of tubing between your e-cigarette and your instruments, certainly the aerosol is aging as it travels. So as with any aerosol instrumentation or as with any aerosol experiment, keeping tubing as short as possible is advantageous, particularly for something like this where it's very dynamic and you're trying to capture the most realistic aerosol picture possible.
Someone is asking which country has the highest use of e-cigarettes. I don't know. Did you read about that, Andrea?
Sorry, yeah, I don't know the answer. I think you could look at it different ways. You know, which country has the highest number of e-cig users versus the highest per capita e-cig users? So I'm not familiar with those statistics. No, I think it's an interesting question.
What is the main substrates used for the impactors?
So those are frequently aluminum foils that come with the impactors. You can also use commercially available filters. That said, they're not actually acting as filters. Air is not going through them. They're acting as surfaces, right? So say you purchased a PTFE filter that you might normally, you know, use for some other experiment where you have air pulled through that PTFE filter. Here you would take that PTFE filter, you would put it on the impactor stage, right? So it has a flat metal plate that it's lying on, and then the particles deposit onto that PTFE surface. So that's one example would be a PTFE. But different types of substrates can be used. If you would like to talk details about that, then we certainly can. Please feel free to email either myself or Francisco or your regional TSI manager if you are familiar with that person. One person asks, do you have an opinion on what a typical puff profile is? Does it vary between products? How does puff profile affect characterization? That's a good question. I think a fairly typical puff profile would be a 3 to 5 second puff, and maybe a 3 second puff, and then a 27 or 30 second period of non-puffing. And it does, I think, vary between products. There is a standard puff profile that's been developed, as Sherry mentioned. There's an ISO standard for it. So for conducting research, then I suppose following that ISO standard would be valuable. How does puff profile affect characterization? I suppose that changing the puff profile significantly could alter device performance. You know, perhaps the e-cigarette will heat up more, right? For example, and that would change the aerosol size. Generally, is e-cigarette worse than normal cigarette? Unfortunately, we're not in a position to comment on that. That's a good question. The question is about health effects, really. So we are an instrumentation company, and we'd like to help people do their research, but we're unfortunately not in a position to comment on health effects. Oh, wow. Okay. So we've got several questions here in Q&A that I missed. Let's see. Is nicotine polluting the instrument? And if so, does that need particular treatment for cleaning? No. As Sherry had said, these instruments are built to size or to characterize aerosols. So if that aerosol contains nicotine, it can probably contains 13 other things as well, right? And the instrument will handle it and size it appropriately, and it will end up on a filter within the instrument. Let's see, regarding cleaning instruments, as I'd mentioned earlier, there are diagnostic criteria you can use to determine if an instrument needs cleaning if you see it having a certain symptom. You know, the manual or a maintenance guide can advise you on whether the instrument, whether cleaning is warranted at that time. Oh, someone else chimes in regarding worldwide usage. In 2019, Healthy Ireland reported 5% of the Irish population are e-cig users. So there we have a per capita data point. So thank you very much. Someone asks, is the filter or aluminum foil glued on the metal surface of the impactor, or is it just put on it? It's laid on it, and then in some cases, depending on the model of the impactor, there's a ring that you snap on to the rim of the filter, because the stage is like the same diameter as the filter. So you snap on this ring that kind of hugs the substrate to the stage. So certainly they don't fly off, and you don't have to adhere them. Someone has asked, if you change the temperature or the power or the e-liquid, does that change the aerosol? And our colleague Tim chimes in that more power equates to larger aerosol. More flow through the device results in more dilution.
Well, we are at 5 minutes past now.
Yes, we are.
And several people have logged off. So it's great to see so much interest. I know we didn't get to everyone's questions, but as we mentioned, feel free to contact us. We will be happy to keep answering your questions and have discussions with you. So thank you so much for joining the webinar, and have a good day.
Thank you, everyone.